And some years ago, Tara was obsessed and was reading this book, which I've brought, called Dialogue with Death by Eknath Ishwaran. And when she was talking to me about it, I said, you know, Tara, you really need to talk to all of us. And so we got all the facilitators from Drishya and all my team from Project Vision, and we went off to Navadarshanam, where she read parts of Eknath Ishwaran's Dialogue with Death, which is based on the master story of the Katha Upanishads. So how are we here today to talk about story as a pedagogy if we can't go to the fountainhead from which a lot of our own wisdom on storytelling began? And she kind of introduced us to all of us who were there, the ideas, the dualities in these conversations that happened between Nachiketa and Yama about, in particular, the trouble with choices. How does one make a decision? Now, yesterday, Geeta and I were talking over dinner, and she said, so what's your stake on story as pedagogy? What's your position? And I thought about it, and I gulped a bit, and then I said two things. I said, I have only one stake on story as pedagogy, and that is to change and alter one's mental, one's consciousness, right? If we can aspire as teachers, as educators, as artists, for an altered state of being, then that's all we need to be able to do. And somehow in that nugget that Tara pushed before me, and then I pushed before all of them, and we went off to Navadarshanam, we started thinking. And in my journey, I'm really very fortunate that I have students at Srishti. To me, they are my teachers. And there was this young girl, Mrinmayi, whose story I'm going to share today. And Mrinmayi never wanted to do a regular diploma project, right? She kind of moaned and groaned and said, you know, there's no value and everything sucks and why the hell do we have to do all this commercial rubbish? And then I took her with me to Tara's Navadarshanam workshop. And then she went off to hear Mumtaz Ali speak at an event that Anita organized on one of the terraces in Sadashiv Nagar. And then she came back and she said, you know, young people like us are constantly stuck in this world of making choices. Shreya and Priya are very real to us. So I'd like to locate my work in trying to use the story to help people make decisions. So I'm proud here to present Mrinmayi's diploma video, and I'm just going to say the connection here with Katha, right? And with multilingualism and with plurality. The story that Mrinmayi based her work on is Jalebiya. And now, Jalebiya is written in Hindi. We used it in Kannada, translated by the faculty, you know, by the Drishya team, not by anybody else. And we did it with people over a few days to understand their dilemmas and to understand how they actually faced choices in their lives. Thank you. The story on which it was based, the pedagogy, is that in Jalebian there's this little moral dilemma that a young boy is thinking, where he's given money by his mother to go pay his school fees, and on the way he's tempted to spend it to buy the sweets, the jalebis, and this question of choice. And as you can see, the girls there wanted to tell the story about when you're riding a bicycle and a boy grabs your chain, do you actually stay and fight for the chain, or do you run away? And the tiger, which is mythically the boy, actually is flies because everybody comes and they fight. And it's a story where the students did it on stop motion animation, understood what it was, took the cameras and all the pictures, incidentally, out of them lying on the ground with the camera on the top and taking the pictures and how they tell their story. And the twin concepts that came from the Katha Upanishads there were the twin concepts of Shreya and Priya, where when you have choices, and I'm going to read now, he says that, Yama, when he talks, he says that everybody who has choices has two alternatives in what you do, say, or think. And these alternatives have precise Sanskrit names that have no English equivalent, Priya and Shreya. And Priya is what is pleasant, Shreya is what is beneficial. Priya is that which pleases us, that which tickles the ego. Shreya, on the other hand, has no reference in pleasing or displeasing. It simply means what benefits us and that which improves our health or contributes to our peace of mind. And it was these excerpts from the Katha Upanishad that were discussed with the students. The students then came up with their own story and then annotated and made their story. And so that is my first example of story as pedagogy, starting from a katha book, working with students, getting them to really think about how they could expand themselves, expand their inner self. But we didn't stop there. The Jalebiya story went on, and in another school that I'm associated with, which is Aditi, we kind of put it together in a slightly different way. In schools like Aditi, to learn Hindi is an awfully difficult job because nobody wants to learn Hindi. I mean, the South Indian hang-up on that continues. And Gulab Jain, who's here, Gulab Ji, was actually using this in his Hindi class to get reluctant sixth graders to actually read a whole book on their own. And as Geeta very eloquently put it, our goal while we were doing this program at Aditi was not just to get kids to read. I'm continually appalled that most people think that learning how to read just involves learning a script almost by heart and memorizing it, that nobody comprehends what it is. So on one hand, while Gulab Ji was working with the kids in their book club to read Jalebiya, Mrinmay and Babita and Alisha and many others were trying to get the students to tell their story about Shreya and Priya, using very much a cafe conversation model that we're using here today with prompts and tables and collaborative discussions. But this time, they used a different form to tell the story. The text is actually in Kannada, for those of you who figured it out. They're telling the story in Kannada. The Kannada was the third language, and our third language teacher is also here. But they were using Scratch. Now, in order to tell a story in Scratch, you have to program. And in order to write a program, you have to think computationally. Right? And computational thinking and algorithmic thinking is completely different from a stop-motion animation, which is linear and sequential. And so here, on the side, and that's why I've left it, it's actually very nice with sound if I could just play the whole full screen, but that was not my goal today, to entertain you, but to show you the complexity in the programming that the students had to do. And the dilemma here is, should I go and play basketball or should I come to school? Right? Should I go to Mountson for my basketball? And that is their dilemma. Then the Jalebiya story is the delay, but for a kid in Aditi, the story is, should I go to Mounts or should I not come to school on a regular day? I mean, what's the choice? What do I have to do? And the teachers encourage them to actually use Kannada, but then it's too difficult to get the Kannada into the script, so they they used what all our SMS people are doing. They like Sunanda Pushkar, for example, all the SMSs were in Hindi, but in English script. So that's what our kids did in Kannada. Can I see show you Scratch in Kannada? I just want to show you that there is this opportunity that you can tell a story, but you can actually, if you look at it, the number of languages that are there, and Scratch as an interface works in Kannada. It also works in Marathi, it also works in Nepali, working on the Hindi interface at the moment, and we can do it in Telugu or Tamil. So students can actually not sit in a monolingual class thinking that IT is in one space and story as a pedagogy is another space and computational thinking is in a third place, that actually it only works when it all works together. And that's really what this exercise was all about. And this particular project is credited to my ADP student, Alisha, who worked with Babita and with others, Dipti and others in the school, translating the same story, one story, two interpretations, two contexts, but one bigger idea. Kids love stories, they do have choices and dilemmas, and making them talk about it is much easier when you're using this kind of pedagogical frame. And thank you for that frame, because Jalebiya is a wonderful story to talk about Shreya and Preya. These are stories done in embroidery. They use conductive thread, and they are interactive. And this was done over just a period of a few days. And the question that Alisha asked is, how can collaborative making help us connect to each other? So the storytelling of connecting to each other. If we can go to the next screen. So what she started out with, these are students from Drishyas in Srishti. They are actually taking cheap electronic toys apart and trying to understand how circuits work. So science and storytelling are not separated into two classes, resistive material, and again, what is a circuit? I love that little one where the little girl is using the thing on her feet to actually test whether something is conductive or not. Then they made little cards for their family, which actually lit up interactive stories, so cards that went out. Then they started embroidering and using circuits. Again, you see there's electricity, there's electronics, there's embroidery, there's handwork, and there's storytelling. And then the quilt is made up of three parts. Each student made a personal story as a central frame, then handed it to others who made the before and the after. You know, every story has a beginning, middle, and end. So every student made their middle frame, and somebody else told the story before, and somebody else told the story afterwards. And there they are with their quilts which light up. They programmed it. That's what the collaborative storytelling quilt looked like. And then when they had an open house, can we go back? People came and changed the parts. So you could actually change it, and they could tell another story. And what we learned in this is that the story is a very, very powerful way when it's driven by the self. When you put the self at the center of storytelling, and then again, we don't say, well, it's the physics teacher who has to teach me about electricity and circuits, and I can't do that with handwork and art and embroidery. And that storytelling is something that either I do in my drama class, or maybe I do something about a story in my literature class. And a story is only something that you have to read. It's not something that actually has any relevance to me. This was one of Alisha's projects just before she flew away and now sent this to me and many other things like the Scratch stories last night on it. So she's still connected to all of what's going on here, even though she's, for the time being, far away from all of us, and I miss her dearly. If we are to look at stories about self, and we start with a master storyteller, and I move from Drishya back to my other world, which is Aditi. The master storyteller is, the story that we have is Ramanujam. And Ramanujam's the flowering tree into which gender and power and loneliness and friendship and all the Shreya and Preya dilemmas are very concretely portrayed. Now, we don't go do Bloom's taxonomy in our pedagogy, right? We don't say, can you identify, can you classify, can you list, can you think? If you know, if I set you 5 questions, tell you the answers, learn them off by heart, and if you know them, I'll give you 10 out of 10. That's not our approach to pedagogy. I share with you the work of people in this room who are artists, storytellers, who actually turned the flowering tree into a very emotional experience for 7th graders.
Each one of us, I feel, had something that we wanted to try. That how does this production and this process become a way for young people to talk about the issues that are in their lives?
We are Gaia's friends.
I'm the optimistic friend, Sneha.
And I'm the pessimistic friend, Pranaya. When we do our Dear Diary scenes, they really show examples about what happens in our real lives, like every day, like our fears and things that happen in our class. So that's what really connects to our lives.
Dear Diary. So tomorrow is the day, new school and all. Everybody's delighted that I got the scholarship. They say it's a great school, but I really don't want to go. It's one of those schools.
Will I look like a princess? Or will I look like a poor girl dressed as a princess? Oh God, I hope people don't laugh at me.
Girls in expensive clothes and perfect hair. And me? I'm going to stand out like Bhelpuri in a French food festival. Like a sumo wrestler in a beauty contest.
I had to design Advit's puppet. So I sat down with Advit and asked him what he wanted, and he said that the king was a very demanding man. So I made the king kind of plump, and I made his arms to the side so that when he walks or when he's standing still, he'll look, you know, kind of big and demanding.
Our next task was to create a symbol for Advit. So I created an avatar of a crown, but it's a hat. So I started off by putting single LEDs and connecting it to one lily pad. And then after that, it never worked because of a short circuit, so I attached an LED string, which works like this.
No, no chance of being alone. I know what you boys are up to when you're alone.
No, Papa, please. Sometimes
shame on you teenagers. All our lives we do everything for you, and then you just want to be alone? Tell me what's wrong now.
When we talk about how students related the story to their own lives and to lives that they have seen others do, was how to not let it remain at introspection, but to kind of turn it where that can be shared in a creative and a theatrical sense. So how do you keep the honesty of the introspection, but how do you then sort of transform it so that then it becomes accessible not just to you but to a larger audience? And I think that's something we worked extensively on. So like all the dialogues that you see were largely generated by the kids, keeping in mind the sort of language they use. So we're talking about a folk tale, but we are seeing how can I relate to it? How can a contemporary audience relate to it? So, you know, we're not speaking the language of kings and queens. The story is about kings and queens, but we are sort of relating it to the kings and queens within us. How we behave like prince, and, you know, when we are like really, say, I want it. It's like we are, you know, how we take on these royal attitudes, how we put on airs.
The heart took a really long time. I had 3 designs before this. This is the final one. The first one had 27 LEDs, but the chip wasn't available, so I couldn't do what I was supposed to do. And then the second design, only 2 LEDs would light up when I needed more to light up. And then the third design again did not work. And when we're going to be LEDs inside this, so when Pavan sees Gaia, he just has to like hit his heart or whatever, and it starts like beating.
First, how you see technology not as something else, but how do you make it really personal? And second, how do you kind of use technology to express different emotions, you know, of what's happening in the play? Greed, love, sorrow, or pressure. How do you kind of use technology as a form of expressing those emotions through different kinds of interactions? And third, most important thing was experimentation. There was the process involving trying different kinds of methods, and technology can be tricky, like things sometimes work and things sometimes, most of the times, doesn't work. And also, how do you kind of explain this to kids, because you know they were also trying different times and they often came to me and asked me a solution which I myself didn't have. And there were some times when they really amazed me of you know, bringing the idea of, okay, can we do something from really far distance where we can control the actors while we are sitting in the audience? And I'm like, I haven't heard of anything like that, but let us explore. And to my amazement, it's like, it's just the concept and things start coming in, you know, and it starts becoming real.
So as you can see here, the struggle was really that, you know, when Zia's got her hands up and the lights are changing, the boys are actually doing it with remotes from the audience, right? So they had designed her costume so that as the emotions changed, the color changed. And so again, what I'm trying to say is the story became their story because they had the Dear Diary. And while on a drama, so the play went at two levels, Ramanujam's story in the front with the shadow puppets, and at the back, the Dear Diary, where the kids are talking from their voices about being lonely in a new school, what will happen to me. And this kind of making these conversations happen, I think was part of the way we dealt in the curriculum with wellness. It is something that I argue all the time. And I'm so happy that Vivek is here, because he, you know, I feel that all of us have to share and get up and fight. Because in my view, the wellness of the children of our country is at stake because they are being destroyed by schooling. We're removing from children the right to express themselves. We're reducing stories to something to be learnt by heart through question and answer. And the amount that in both the stories that you saw, whether it was the snap quilts or whether it was in the flowering tree, the amount of transformation, agency and autonomy it gave to share very personal and intimate parts of your life in a way that you could do it safely and make a very good performance out of it was something that I was very proud to see, and I was very happy to see the enabling atmosphere in which that was made to happen. So we go again to the oldest of our stories, to Kalidasa, and to Mrichakatika, and to my friends here, to Tara, and to Dipti, who produced it, to Vanya, and others, Sudhabi, Gulabji, all of whom who worked on it, who actually put together a very old play for very young 21st century children.
What would a 21st century teenager have to do with a play written in Sanskrit 1,800 years ago? Would the sensibility and values of those times make any sense at all to a Facebook-savvy, globalized product of our modern age? And most importantly, even if they were given this exposure to the ancient culture of Ujjaini, would they ever want to get into the roles of characters that are so very dated? The relevance of this play, The Little Clay Cart, Mrichakatika, is the timeless appeal of the characters, plot and values embedded in this piece. Bringing it into the ken of today's 13-year-olds is quite another matter. Sanskrit theatre, Natya Shastra, Yakshagana and Kathak. A hairy mix that not even a 13-year-old, jean-clad, SMS-toting kid can resist. What evolves is a new punch, tradition reinterpreted in the voice of today's youngster. Tanana 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 tanadirina tadirina tadirina tanana 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 tanadirina.
This is the city of Ujjaini.
Oh, in Madhya Pradesh!
Yes, but a long time ago. The people here are unhappy. Do you know why?
Oh, yes. Because of great King Palaka. He divided the city in two. The royals and the laborers. The rich and the poor. The Pushpa Karandaka forest. I better park the carriage.
Was to take a very old script and turn it into something, and I just want to connect it with what you said, that's to, you know, to really talk about forests and know that forests are not just, you know, somewhere in the past, but also today. They did a Hindi unit on Madhya Pradesh and they connected it all together. I've already given a warning that we're sort of going wrong on time. I want to show you another clip. That to me, story as pedagogy is also about the art of bringing a traditional storytelling into the classroom.
कहानी जो है वो सुनाई जाती है तो अलग अलग उसके तरीके हैं सुनाने के. ये जो कहानी की जो फॉर्म तरीका जो था बताने का, एक पानवाड़ी स्टाइल से जो है वो थोड़ा सा प्रेरित है. तीजन बाई हुई हैं, अभी है बहुत बड़ी लोक गायिका है वो, और वो महाभारत की जितनी भी कथाएं हैं वो सारी कथाएं जो है वो इसी तरीके से गाकर और बीच में इस कहानी को बताकर वो पेश करती.
सच्चाई की विजय हुई, हारे कौरव अभिमानी.
Gulab ji did, and he's here, is he was teaching Hindi. Can we give him a round of applause? To Standard 8 who didn't want to learn Hindi. This is an NBT textbook. But what we did was he turned the story into Pandwani. So the Hindi class was in Pandwani. And then with the help of others, he turned the Pandwani into a Hindi podcast so that the kids could listen to it whenever they wanted to and therefore could read their book at the same time when they're listening to the Pandwani. And we found that suddenly this whole story came alive to them. And it came alive in a way that technology, history, and thing. And these kids didn't even know what the Pandwani form of storytelling was, but it definitely improved their whole motivation, perhaps, for wanting to connect with a language that they didn't really connect with at all. I think I only have now two small excerpts to show with you. Is the next one an audio file? Am I right? Okay, just so that I have my script in my head. I've shown you a lot of stories, but I haven't given you an audio story. What actually happened was my friend Padmini and my other friend Sudhibi, who was here, they were involved in teaching science. And they were trying to teach students about monster storms. And the students worked in four groups: storm stirrers, monsoon messengers, hurricane hunters, and twisting tornadoes. Which one can you hear? So which one was it? The monsoon or a hurricane? Or was it a tornado? Some twisting tornado? Monsoon? Padmini? It was a monsoon, a hurricane, yeah. Now, I just want to just tell you about some of the children who made these compositions. First, they loved it. I would have loved to show you the entire Operation Monster Storms because I think it was the most fantastic way in which science could ever be taught. But again, connecting with Vivek's Sir Tad Talks last time, these kids who did this story and who got a very powerful memory of what the monsoon is, it is only when they were given this opportunity, Vivek, that they actually feel that they were really creative and successful. All their lives they had been told that they were really not very good because they could not parrot back what the teacher had sent to them. And I just want to say that while on one hand we say creativity is all very well, what kind of opportunities do we frame in the classroom for teachers to actually allow students their own ways of telling a story, even if it is about a storm. And in this, they used all kinds of ways in which sound could be created, rubbing paper together, banging things in the classroom. It's not like they were working in an audio studio, right? What's my last bit? Yeah, but I know what you mean. I'd had to remember what the next one was. The last one is a clip from Drishya. Contemporary storytelling, puppetry, makey-makey, and electronic circuits. Vanya Sahi, who's here, Gautam Dayal, and the teachers of the Drishya Kalika Kendra, who are part of that puppet making class. I know it's late, I know I'm running out of time, so I'm not going to go back to putting propositions on your table and allowing you to discuss it, because I think that you'd much rather be taking the car, bus, or auto home. So I told Arzu I would close. We can spend a lot of time sitting at tables and deliberating the value of what you see. But frankly, I'm not saying anything different from what Geeta is saying. All I've given you is examples of what is happening here in Bangalore, in two institutions that I have been, three institutions, Srishti as well, because Srishti kids have very often been the people who've connected the dots and made things happen. I think as educators, and I'm talking here to trustees, one of the special things about CERTAT talks is I say that you always have to come with a trustee or a principal, boards of management, because otherwise the teacher is powerless, because the teacher themselves don't have the ability to make change. But as teachers, as boards of trustees, as ordinary everyday human beings, we also have to listen to Yama and to Nachiketa. We have dilemmas before us. And Priya stands in front of us every day. I read first from Eknath Ishwaran and then I will just add my two bits. Priya has a well-developed sales pitch, he says, for almost any product. He carries a little briefcase of graphs and tables and other convincing multimedia presentations to bolster his arguments. The evidence is unsubstantial, he says, pointing to his charts. There is no controlled study to show that lung cancer or emphysema is caused by smoking. I propose to you today that that's what dominates the dilemma of or any discussion on education. We're dominated by quantification, by measurement, by results. And almost everywhere I go, I'm extremely saddened on the day when the results come out. Because the only cause to celebrate is that your school has got 100%. That instant gratification that we have, and that we should get the name of our school in the popular press and mass media, dominates everybody, including all the trustees, management people, educators, and the classroom teacher. Nobody talks about what people have learnt. Whether we could have, in fact, been like Shreya. Shreya has a difficult time because nobody wants to hear her. We think she wants to keep us from things that make life enjoyable. Her wares are unattractive. Good health, security, peace of mind. We actually would like to have them, but they're not fun to have. It's painful to think of giving this up, giving something up to gain them. So I'm going to leave you with a provocative proposition to all of you. I think, like Geeta and Tara and many others who are fighters, Vivek, fighters for the future of India, there has to be a platform for action. And that action has to go beyond prayer, beyond the instant gratification of marks and results. I went outside for coffee and Vivek, who's now left, said, Geeta, how many more years must we do this? How many more years must we fight? Because somebody will say, well, will this get you a job? To me, if somebody doesn't commit suicide, that is enough. Thank you. Good night.